Well, good morning and welcome to our first part of a new series, Responding in Faith. And I just wanted to let you guys know that every single one of Pastor Phil's sermons is just a miracle. And yesterday, he had put his finishing touches on his sermon on his iPad there, and he tossed the iPad on the bed and the whole thing deleted and ran and just re-downloaded, right, from the Lord, his whole sermon again. And his response really spoke to me, because I don't know about you, but I would have fallen on the floor and been praying for an attitude adjustment, you know, before I did anything else. And he's just, oh, Satan is a liar, you know, and he's back at it, he's back in his office, and just was able to recall everything that the Lord had just poured into his heart.
Amen.
So I just wanted to appreciate you, and we are all just so blessed by you. Thank you, Lord, for Pastor Phil. We thank you that he is someone who truly seeks your kingdom, Lord, and we just thank you for everything that you are adding unto him, Lord, as he is just following after you with all of his heart. Lord, we just thank you that he has your heart for all of us, and we just thank you for him. We just want to pray a blessing over the word as we all hear it and receive it, and may we bury it deep in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, sweetie. Hallelujah. Well, welcome. It's going to be a standalone, not a series, because I had promised you guys a series on living better, not bitter, and but I felt that it's important that we respond after the conference and talk a bit more about faith. Hallelujah. I believe that over the years, that one of the biggest mistakes or challenges with faith or understanding faith is simply that they put this guilt upon people that we need more faith. And people have responded to God more in guilt rather than from a place of rest that it has already been provided. So I want to emphasize this today, brothers and sisters. You do not need more faith. Faith is not something that is out there. Faith is something that has already been provided through the atonement of Jesus. Now, all we need to do is to respond to it by faith. Hallelujah. 2 Peter 1, 3, the Passion Translation says, everything we could ever need for life and godliness has already been deposited in us by his divine power. For all this was lavished upon us through the rich experience of knowing him who has called us by name and invited us to come to him through a glorious manifestation of his goodness. It was his goodness that led us to repentance. The next verse. As a result of this, he has given you magnificent promises that are beyond all price, so that through the power of these tremendous promises, we can experience partnership with the divine nature by which you have escaped the corrupt desires that are of the world. Hallelujah. Earlier on, Pastor Nelda led us in the time of communion, and she kept on saying, partake, partake. That word partnership, I read it from the Passion Translation in the actual King James, it says, to partake of his divine nature. And how we respond by faith is simply to partake of what God has already provided. That word partnership or partake, it means a partner, associate, a comrade, or companion, a sharer in anything. The Holy Spirit is our companion. The Holy Spirit is our partner. And he will come alongside of you and begin to lead you, guide you on how to access this grace. Faith is not complicated. Faith is simply responding towards, is a positive response towards the grace of God. So that word partnership or partake in that verse is the Greek word kononas, and it's the same family of word for communion, which is kononia, and it means fellowship, association, community, communion, joint participation, or intercourse. So you see similar words, participation, association. God has called us into this partnership. That's one of my favorite words. Partner. You see, when you understand that whatever God has called you to do, He has not left you alone. He's your partner. He's your associate. And the Bible tells us in Ephesians 2 verse 8, it says, "For we were saved by grace through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." So even with salvation, God did not leave you alone. His prevenient grace went ahead of you through people's prayers, through the love of God that drew us towards Him. It softened our hearts, and then we responded to the grace of God by putting our trust in what Jesus did for us on Calvary. That is what it means to be saved by grace through faith. And the same way we all became born again is the same way we're all going to continue to receive from God. The Bible tells us that Jesus did not come, John 3, 17, says God did not send His Son to condemn the world, but to save the world. Sozo. Healed, saved, delivered. He came to make us whole. And the same wholeness applies into every aspect of life, be it physical healing, be it finances, be it deliverance from afflictions of the enemy. Jesus is in the saving business. So without faith, God's grace is wasted. It's a crash course in the balance of grace and faith. Without faith, God's grace is wasted. Romans 5:2, through Him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. That word access means admission. Faith grants you admission into grace. And without grace, faith is powerless. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace toward me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Wow. Faith demands a positive response, and that positive response is towards the grace of God. So here's the key verse for this message today, Hebrews 4, verse 2. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. And that's why after that amazing two-day conference or revival, we needed to pause and ask ourselves, what did you hear? What did you experience? Now, are you going to mix it with fear or with faith? Are you going to focus on your problems? Are you going to focus on the promise? Are you going to act on what God spoke to you and continue to hold fast to your confessions when you declared, I am free? Are you going to continue to believe that you are free, or are you going to go back to your old way of thinking? It did not profit them anything. Why? Because they did not mix it with faith. You can come to church, listen to great messages online, and even get prayed for by the most anointed ministers, but still not profit anything if you do not respond in faith. We were saved by grace through faith. Some people preach more faith than grace. Some people preach more grace than faith. No, the two work together. Through grace, we were saved, but we had to put our faith in what God had already done. Hallelujah. Diana's going to be bringing a word next Sunday on activating faith. And Hebrews 4 verse 3 says, for those of us who believe, faith activates the promise. And she's going to be giving us some four or five key simple steps on how to activate our faith. But let us grow in understanding what faith is. James 1, 5 to 7 says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith. This is a whole sermon on its own. In fact, I struggled to put this so that I wouldn't go on a rabbit trail. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. This scripture tells us clearly that when we do things and don't respond in faith, we don't receive anything from the Lord. Do you know how many times people do stuff and don't ask in faith? Do you know how many times people go into a job search and they've not really paused to pray about it? Do you know how many times people want to buy a new car and they've not really taken time to say, Lord, lead me, guide me. Lord, open my eyes. Lord, what car would you have me buy? The car I have outside in prayer, I sense God wanted to bless me with a new car. And as I was praying, responding to God's provision and promise, I had a trance and I saw a red car. And I stepped out in faith and I drove to the car dealership and I saw the first car dealership I saw. I saw the red car, I knew what I wanted, leather seats, entertainment package for my kids, three row seats because I was also the family pastor in charge of youths. And I needed to take some long mission trips for camps, and I needed to carry at least seven youths in my car. God fully provided. All I just needed was to see what God had already provided. See, faith in its simplest form is simply God's nature inside of you. Don't overthink it. You already have the faith of God. Galatians 5, 22 to 23. But the fruits of the Spirit. How many of you have the Holy Spirit? Let me see your hand. Have your hand. Amen. So you have the same faith that raised Jesus from the dead. The same Spirit. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law. So we already have, you see, that's why faith is a gift. We were saved by grace through faith. This of itself is a gift from the Lord. So we believed, then the Holy Ghost brought the full package. Then His divine nature inside of us now begins to compel us and lead us to receive and trust God. Because that word faith means pistis, is the Greek word pistis, and it basically means inner conviction. Inner conviction of the truth, confident assurance in God. I had a confident assurance that God was leading me not just to buy a car, but to buy a red car, and I had a strong sense of how much. And in fact, and He gave me a prophetic word, in 3 months, I'll pay it off. And I took a step of faith. We never really do financing, and we went against our human nature, and we financed, and in less than 3 months, God was able to pay that car off. It's the only way we can truly please God through faith, through our God's nature in us. That's why we all have to become born again Christians. See, a lot of us are born again and we don't even realize what we have. We don't even realize we have a fully paid car inside of us. We don't even realize we got divine protection inside of us. We don't realize we have an associate, a comrade, a companion to fight for us, with us, to guide us. But remember, the Bible says that it is through coming to know Him. In other words, it's a progression. It's a relationship. To the degree to which you know God will be the degree to which you can manifest His goodness. 2 Peter 1, verse 2. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and Christ Jesus. And if you look at it in the Amplified, you see that that word peace means prosperity. Prosperity is multiplied through your knowledge of God. Not the knowledge of what you've done for God, but the knowledge of what God has done for you. Not the knowledge of how much you love Him, but the knowledge of how much He loves you. Wow. When we rest in this promise, when we rest in this understanding, faith is activated. I gave you the testimony before this, how I got a hotel for our vacation before I had the money in faith. Why? God spoke to me. In July, you go for a vacation. When the opportunity came up, you know what? I responded in faith. The next morning, God had taken care of that need. Hallelujah. Men, key into these promises and become aggressive sometimes, even in trusting the Lord. Because I know sometimes I share, and some of you are like, okay, well, that's you, Pastor Phil. Okay, you're in ministry. Oh, and some people even think, oh, well, you know certain people. No. No. Faith will turn the hearts of kings like a stream towards you. This morning, Lord was speaking to me. You see, God has spoken to me because I believe so much in prosperity. I believe that the gospel does prosper. Let me rephrase that. And one way, and I've come to understand that prosperity is having more than enough and little left over so that you can be a blessing. So I've made a covenant with the Lord, and I've told the Lord that my account in Nigeria belongs to Him. And as the Lord continues to fill it, I'll continue to support His church. I take care of missionaries, I take care of pastors, I pay people's rent, I've helped people with 50% of a car purchase more than once. I can go on. I paid some people's school fees, I pay people's Bible course. And the Lord continues to take care of that account for His glory. Because I put my faith in Him. And guess what? Faith is also wisdom. Whatever I'm sowing in Nigeria, I'm reaping in America. And if God can speak, where I'm going with this is that if God can speak to me, put aside this money. Somebody's going to need it. All of a sudden, there was a good friend of mine. God just put it in my heart. I started praying for him. All of a sudden, he just called me that week. He said, man, pastor, right now, the landlord just, I said, stop. God already told me. How much is it? The exact money I had in my account. Now, if God can speak to me concerning someone's need, do you think God can speak to someone concerning your need? You see, faith has to have an expectation. Some of us, our relationship with God does not see past your own resources. Some of us, your love for yourself cannot see other people loving you the way God wants to love you. Faith is beyond your understanding. And I have radical expectation. Expectation is the mother of manifestation. When I pray, I believe in my heart, as the scripture says, whatsoever we desire when we pray, and we believe we shall have it, we shall receive it. God is not necessarily answering your prayers. God is answering the desires of your heart. I want to encourage you. I want to challenge you to dream. I want to inspire you and remind you that God wants to meet all your needs according to His riches and glory. Wow. You see, when we became born again, something amazing happened. There was a spiritual awakening. John 3 verse 3 says, Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. When Jesus says, I tell you the truth, he's like saying, basically, I swear. Now he didn't swear, but he's saying, look, he's trying to say, I need to get your attention. He's truth, full of grace and truth, and he's saying, I tell you the truth. Jesus doesn't need to say, I tell you the truth, because he's truth. But he's saying, I tell you the truth. Oh, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. That word see in Greek, it means to see with the mind, to perceive, to know, to behold, become acquainted with by experience to experience. It is only through the divine nature of God, faith, pistis, within each and every one of you, can you see, comprehend, perceive, and take hold of it by faith. Your human mind cannot believe it. Your human mind cannot believe that by this time next week, God will take care of some of your bills. Your human mind cannot believe that by the end of this service, God will begin to turn some things around in your life by now. That's why the Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. And in that context, it's talking about the preacher preaching. As the preacher is preaching, someone who has researched the word of God, someone who they knew that he was putting his reputation online and speaking to the public, because that kind of person makes the effort to speak God's word and has sought God's word out. When the preacher is speaking, that kind of faith, that kind of message releases faith. I'm telling you, God is doing stuff in your lives. Have you heard the story of the lepers? They encountered Jesus. Right now, we're hanging out with Jesus. The Bible says that as they were leaving, they were healed. As some of you are leaving church today, God will turn your situations around. Amen. By the end of today, God, look, I expect phone calls to ring. Oh my. I'm telling you. We have to learn how to pray until shalom happens in our soul. Once that peace comes, remember it means prosperity, faith is activated. I don't want to segue here, but you know the first motorcycle I got, God was teaching me how to pray unto shalom, happens in my soul. In other words, when God gives you a promise, you pray until there's a peace, and then you know it is settled. You know that faith has been released. And I was praying on the mission field, and it's going into the third hour, not just 5 minutes. And he told me, literally, I'm teaching you how to pray until the phone rings. And as I was praying, 5 minutes to the third hour, the phone rang. One of my closest friends back then, he just called me. He says, hey, man. It just dawned on me that all this while, you know, you've been doing ministry, you're my pastor. I've never really sowed anything to your life. I just sowed a big plot of land, and I thought I'll sow my tithes into your life for the first time. This was 2007 or 6. Anyways, cut the long story short. By faith, God has spoken to me and promised me a motorcycle. Why? Because on the mission, on the way, I'd actually bought a motorcycle that I was supposed to collect at the border in the next city, but a friend of mine gambled that money away. Long story for another day. So I had to forgive him. And in that process of forgiving him and not calling the police, the Lord told me, because you forgive him, I'll replenish. So I stepped into the next country, believing God and expecting God to be true to his word. So how did I respond in faith? I didn't just sit down there and name it and claim it. You know what? I went shopping and I found the motorcycle that I wanted. And peace, you must always be led by peace. Faith is a confident conviction. There has to be a conviction. I saw the particular motorcycle I wanted. I felt the Lord leading me concerning the price. I didn't have the money. You know what I did? I told the guy, can you give me 2 weeks? And I gave him my international passport. Can you give me 2 weeks? If I haven't gotten this money in 2 weeks, you can sell this motorcycle. He agreed. Less than 2 weeks, the motorcycle then cost in Ghanaian money about 13 million CDs. Don't worry, it's not as much as you think. My friend called. He says, I've sent this money. The bank has to take its percentage. By the time the bank took its percentage, guess what was left? 13 million CDs. Oh my God. Hallelujah. I've seen God work in my life over and over and over. But every time I had to respond by what? Faith. You see, everything about faith is God working in you, both to will and to do. In simple terms, faith is just God's nature in you. So approach that situation, first of all, that you already have the victory. God is bigger than that situation. God has already provided. Now you begin to pray, you begin to renew your mind, until peace comes, until God quickens you to make the right choice, to go in the right direction, because you need wisdom. You need to pray in accordance with his will. 1 John 5:14. Whatever is in accordance, this is the confidence we have. That whatever is in accordance with God's will, it gives him great pleasure to give it. And the reason why people pray amiss is because sometimes they go praying or looking for what God has not given them. But in the context of God's word, we know some things that God has already given us. Healing, protection, meeting needs, not once, okay? But don't get me wrong, you can build a relationship with God and tap into favor, and he can give you a want. My motorcycle right there, at this age and stage and maturity in my life, believe it, is a want. I sold it, the thing refused to sell. God gave it back to me. He says, I just love you like that. Now I'm even giving you your wants. Amen? Scripture. I'll delight in me and I'll give you the desires of your heart. So you see, faith and wisdom go together. The Bible, faith is Jesus. Faith is the divine nature of God within you. Okay? 1 Corinthians 1:24 says, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. People always want to experience God's power independent of wisdom. But the wisdom of God leads you to God's power. And the Bible says in Luke 2:52, and Jesus grew in wisdom, in stature, Amplified will say, in broad and full understanding, and in favor with God, and in favor with man. Jesus took time to grow in understanding the ways of God. Jesus took time to renew his mind, his physical body to align with his spiritual man so that he would not be hindered by his five senses to be able to perceive and comprehend what God was saying. You see, the Bible says in John 5:19, remember that word, perceive, partake, associate, all those words, okay? So Jesus answered them by saying, I assure you, most solemnly, I tell you, the Son is able to do nothing of himself, of his own accord, but he is able to do only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does is what the Son does in the same way in his turn. Boy, this is where a lot of people miss it. They try and do what they want, and then they say, God bless it. Faith is not going outside of God's word, or God's timing, or seasons in life. 2010, I had gotten a better job. The ministry youth pastor overseeing the young men and the youths and the adolescents or youths in Nigeria. I think the different age from the adolescents here in the United States. I was feeling ready. Okay, moved into a new apartment. God had blessed me with an SUV. My human mind just thought, okay, this is the year. And as I was praying about marriage, I just heard in my spirit, in faith, say, you may not see your spouse this year. And as it came with a peace and a grace. That grace, that word just sustained me. Prophet Stewart, you all met him when he came. As soon as he came, we're going around and ministering to people. All of a sudden, he just touched me. He just turned and says, I don't feel you're going to meet your spouse this year. That word gave me joy. It gave me the grace to wait for another 3 years. You see, we're reckless with faith. We're reckless with faith. And every time you pray recklessly and you don't see God meet that need, it affects your relationship with God. Because you begin to see a God who does not provide and who does not want to meet every need. Jesus says, I do nothing of my own accord. Guys, you have to come to that place where you have such an intimate relationship with God. You don't even do or say or desire anything that is outside of God's seasons for your life, needs for your life. And that word, see, is the Greek word blepo. It means to look upon, gaze at, discern mentally, observe, perceive, discover, understand. To beware, to turn the thoughts or direct the mind to a thing, to consider, contemplate, to look at, to weigh carefully, examine. You see, people think that faith just comes, faith, all of a sudden, boom, people are going to be raised by the dead. No, faith comes through conversations. Faith comes through teaching. Faith comes through mentorship. Faith comes through just hanging around godly people until, you know what, you begin to hear someone's view about something. Your mind is beginning to turn towards God's ways, outside of you, away from your ways, and then faith is released, and you now begin to get this strong sense, this is what God has called me to do. First time I met my beautiful wife, I told her 2 weeks after, I said, I feel the Lord has called you to be a teacher. She laughed. But you know what? As we began to have that conversation, as we began to do life, the Lord began to, the pistis in her, the Spirit of God began to turn her thoughts, her mind towards the will of God. And at the right time, when another pastor was preaching, she just felt the Lord saying, this is your mission field. Today, I can't stop her. I'm like, please come home, okay? That's her mission field. Because peace came. In fact, she was the only teacher who said yes to that job without asking them what they were going to pay her. Peace. Guys, grace and peace travel together. If you're not walking in peace, it's because you're neglecting grace. And God's grace has already been provided. And faith is just positive focus on grace long enough until the grace begins to empower you to draw close to what God has already provided. And that word doing says, I do nothing except what I see my Heavenly Father doing. So we know now what blepo means, to gaze, to consider, to contemplate. The word doing, it means to make, to produce, to construct, form, to fashion, to make a thing out of something, to appoint, ordain one, to carry out, to execute, to perform, to a promise, to carry out, to execute, or celebrate. In other words, Jesus is just having fun, seeing God at work, And when he sees God at work, Jesus begins to perform in his heart, in his words, what God is performing. Jesus did not pray outside of the will of God. Jesus says, I did not come. I came to do my Father's will. I did not come to abolish the will of God, but to fulfill it. Maybe what is hindering our faith is that we don't fully know, understand God's word. When our mind is saturated with the word of God will begin to quicken you. It will begin to give you the right desires. It will begin to give you the right desires. You just wake up desiring to resign because God has called you to resign. You just wake up desiring to sow seeds because God has led you to sow seeds. You just wake up desiring to expect blessings because God has led you to expect a blessing. I believe that it's not complicated, that if we can just rest in our and partake of this divine nature, then we'll begin to experience all these amazing promises and benefits in God. Partnership. Simple words. A partner. Why don't you come up, Melody? This is my beautiful partner. Okay? The Bible says two cannot walk together except they agree. Okay? Faith demands that you believe that God's word is absolute. Yes. Faith demands that you submit to God and resist the devil. So God says, fear not. Tomorrow will take care of itself. Rest in me. Keep moving forward. This is your partner, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is moving forward, but you're staying back. You're still looking at Egypt. You're still looking at the paycheck. You're still looking at the doctor's report. So can two walk together if they have not agreed? You see, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6:17, you who have become joined with Christ have become one with him. Yeah. One spirit. We are now one. Just as a married couple are one, but just because we're one, it doesn't mean that we always agree. You see, it's not a faith problem. It's an understanding problem. Thank you very much, Pastor Melody. It's a knowledge problem. It's a submission problem. Job says, submit to God and you have peace. Yes. Can you trust God with your life? Can you submit to his leading? Can you submit to his ways? When I wake up and I'm spending time, and you know, guys, I come here at 7 a.m., sometimes even before that, I'm not praying, God, move! No, I'm praying, Phil, submit to God's ways and desires. I'm praying until my five senses shut down and I begin to believe that he has anointed me to heal the sick. That I'm believing and praying until God's nature inside of me is quickened and I have the enough confidence in the Spirit of God that I can be the pastor that he's called me to be. Just like Jesus, I can do nothing. I can do nothing. So your trust in God reflects the time you spend with God. People say, I trust the Lord, I trust the Lord. No, seeing how busy some of us are, it shows that we trust more in ourselves than in God. I trust in his divine nature. I trust in the word of God. I'm spending time, if I can just get one word, one vision, one inspiration, one confirmation. I trust that God's word is enough. Acts 20 verse 32 says, now I entrust you to God and the message of his grace that is able to build you up and give you an inheritance. That's why I spend so much time in the word, eating it, meditating on it, because I know that this word is going to build me up and it's going to give me an inheritance. It's the word of God spoken to me that I'm literally living in an inheritance today. Amen. Yeah. As of 20, was it 2021 or 2022, God spoke to me and showed me the day I would get a house. I believed it. I began to submit to this promise in faith and cast away every doubt, every fear. Coming to that date, we had started the process, nothing. Getting to that date, still nothing. I was still standing on God's word. Because faith is living from the inside out. It was the 28th of June or so, I can't remember. Faith is living from the inside out. Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, it says, we walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. Not by the outward. That's the outward. Sight, Greek word, eidos. Outward. We're so wired to look at the outward. We're so wired to look at the doctor's report. We're so wired to look at the symptoms. We're so wired to look at what people are saying. And the devil was saying a lot of stuff. You missed it. This, I was laughing at him. You know what my faith response was? On that day, even though I didn't see any sign, I said, Satan, you've already been defeated. Yeah. I trust in God so much, I'm not even going to pray about this. On that day, I binged on Netflix. In fact, I think I finished Netflix that day. I just went to bed. I went to rest in his finished work. 3 weeks after, I found out that somebody had sent me the first down payment, but it was stuck in transition in the bank because of some of the stuff that was happening in the political situation in Nigeria. When did he send it? The 28th of June. That day, God fulfilled his word. Hallelujah. That day, God fulfilled his word. Remember that was the theme in the conference? This day. This day. Faith opens your eyes to see the day of the Lord. The Bible says, weeping endured for a night, but joy comes in the morning. So as we round up on this simple reminder on responding in faith, let me remind you that everything we do and everything that was written, everything about ministry, it's all about actually believing in God's promises. Sometimes we get so busy doing stuff, and we don't realize that we haven't even started believing. Grace and peace travel together. If you're not walking in peace, then you're not fully resting in grace. The Bible says in John 20:31, the Passion Translation, but all that is recorded here is so that you will fully believe that Jesus is the Anointed One, the Son of God, and that through your faith in Him, you will experience eternal life by the power of His name. Hallelujah. Amen. All that is written, all that we do, every Sunday, every Kingdom School, is so that we'll actually believe. What does believe look like? Belief looks like a confident expectation in the promises of God. I always like to encourage people to respond. Let us stand up and respond to this message as an act of faith. The Lord, we're agreeing with your word. We're agreeing with your promises. And today, there are some challenges standing before you. There's some circumstances standing before you. All you need to do is to shut down your five senses. That's why traditionally sometimes we close our eyes when we pray, so that we can begin to see through our spirit. Except you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom. Yes. The kingdom is what God has provided. The kingdom realm is within you. And as we close our physical eyes and begin to open our spiritual eyes, we begin to see. And as we begin to see, faith is activated and releases the promise. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you. As an act of faith, we just stretch forth our hands in thanksgiving. We thank you, O Lord Father, that Jesus has fully paid the price. On that cross, he says, it is finished, fully paid, fully provided. All we can do now is trust in the power of his name as Yeshua, our Savior. And I just speak into every situation in your life right now. I speak his name, Yeshua. I speak his name, Jesus. And I declare grace, grace, grace into that situation. Thank you, Lord. I speak to those bills. I speak to those doctor's reports. I speak to those symptoms. I speak to those relational situations. I speak to doubt and anxiety. Be gone in the name of Jesus. Hear the name of the Lord, the name that is greater than every other name, Yeshua. Just believe in that name and receive what God has already provided. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Yeah.